Hey everybody, Trey here, and welcome to the Storm Chaser Coaching YouTube channel. In today's video, we're going to discuss three tools that are underrated and underutilized in storm chasing. Let's go ahead and get started. Our first underrated chasing tool has to do with the forecast process, and it's called the High-Resolution Ensemble Forecast System, or HREF. This comes from the Storm Prediction Center, and it basically takes our convection-allowing models, our CAMs, like the HRRR, the NAM 3-kilometer, and treats them as an ensemble. So instead of looking at just one single convection-allowing model run, which has its issues in itself, it treats them as an ensemble. So it's basically averaging out all of the outputs from the different convection-allowing models and giving us an output that is the average of those. So what that can do is it takes out wonky runs or runs that might be out to lunch from a specific convection-allowing model and averages them all out so we can get a little bit of a better picture overall of how the models are handling the overall environment. So this is the HREF interface, and it's got a bunch of different tools on the top here. One thing that's cool about it is it spits out SPC-esque guidance for hail, wind, and tornado probabilities. So if we clicked on tornado probabilities, this is basically the four-hour neighborhood probability of a tornado. So the probability of a tornado within the last 4 hours leading up to the time of interest. We go forward and then you can see it spits out those SPC-esque probabilities, and we can even zoom in to different sectors as well to give us a closer in view. So that's one thing that's very cool about it. You can get that for hail and wind as well. It also goes through all of our different products that we use when forecasting. So for example, the 500 millibar height and wind, the 700 millibar height and wind, surface temperature and surface dew point and sea level pressure, etc. So once again, this is taking all of our CAMs. For example, this product is the 500 millibar wind, and it's taking all of the output at the 500 millibar level from all of our CAMs and averaging them together. So this is an average of all of our convection allowing models 500 millibar output. And I'll zoom back out to the continental US sector here. So all you do is just arrow through and it gives you this nice graphic with a really easy to read color scale that is the average of all of our outputs. It's a really good tool to use instead of just focusing on one particular convection allowing model run. It allows us to treat them all as a whole, and because we're averaging them out, it takes out some of the wonkiness that individual CAM runs can give us. It also has products for severe weather, so CAPE, storm relative helicity, winter weather stuff, fire weather stuff, precipitation, so quantitative precipitation forecasts. It can go out, and keep in mind that this is short range guidance. These are CAMs. So they only go out maybe 24 to 48 hours in advance at most. But we can go through and look at our quantitative precipitation forecasts over a given time period. This is the 1 hour forecast and stuff like that. One of my favorite tools to use is we go under storm attributes and scroll down to where it says updraft helicity and go to the 4 hour min max updraft helicity 2 to 5 kilometers and we go to max. This is a really good tool to use because, as we know, updraft helicity is basically the model's way of outputting whether or not a storm is rotating. So basically it tells us if the model is projecting supercells. But this gives us a nice probability of updraft helicity streaks from in the 2 to 5 kilometer layer meeting a certain threshold. So in just boiling this all down, it basically tells us the probability of storms that the model is outputting to have robust updraft helicity, and therefore the probability that storms are robust supercells. And again, it's probabilistic. This is not one run that just gives you one output of the simulated reflectivity on radar. It gives you a probability. So for example here, if we zoom in, and this is valid, this is a 4 hour max, so from the 4 hours leading up to 23Z, so 6 p.m. Central Daylight Time, it's giving us probabilities for robust updraft helicity. For example, in this area, the probability of robust updraft helicity exceeding that threshold that this model uses is 50%. So in this bullseye right there, that is where the ensemble convection allowing model system here, the HREF, is spitting out the highest probabilities of robust rotating supercell thunderstorms. Out here we have a 30% contour as well, 10% contour. So this is a really good tool to show you perhaps where the best chances among all the models are for robust supercells. Now, it doesn't tell us anything about the hazards that those might produce. That is up to us to figure out from the environment. But overall, it's a nice, really good tool to use when you're forecasting to pinpoint where the best chances for supercells may be. And if you did want to take a look at all of the individual convection allowing models, we can go under Member Viewer, select Members under Reflectivity, and we have an output of all of our most important cams, the HRRR, the NSSL WRF, the WRF ARW, the FV3, and the NAM 3 kilometer. And we can actually just thumb through them as we would on a typical model site. So you can go forward, see the actual HRRR output. And then if you stop on a certain time, you can go over and change and hover over a different model, and it shows you the output for that model at that specific time. So it's really easy to compare and contrast the model output from each of these models because of this function that lets you stick on the same hour and go from run to run. You can also go back 6 hours and 12 hours, the past 6 hour HRRR, in the past 12 hour for the other cams, because they only come out at 0Z and 12Z. But the HRRR comes out, of course, every hour. So you can actually go back and compare several runs ago, or at least one run ago from these models, to see how the model has evolved over time. For example, the current NSSL WRF valid at 22Z has this output, whereas the NSSL WRF from 12 hours ago, the 0Z run from yesterday evening, showed this. So you can compare and contrast within an individual model the runs of that model, or you can compare from model to model at a certain time, which is a really nice way to, again, not rely on just one particular convection allowing model for our forecast, but compare and contrast among different models, which is the crux of good forecasting. Our next underrated tool is infrared satellite. Unlike visible satellite, which basically shows what the satellite is actually seeing, infrared satellite measures temperatures. You might be thinking, what does this have to do with storm chasing? As we know, temperature decreases as you go up in the atmosphere. So as thunderstorms get taller and more robust, their cloud tops become colder and colder. So when you see the colder cloud tops on infrared satellite, which are the oranges, reds, and even black colors, that indicates taller, more robust thunderstorms. Now, it doesn't tell us anything about the hazards that the thunderstorm might be producing at the surface, but more robust thunderstorms can produce more robust severe hazards. You might also see a signature called an enhanced V, which is very similar to a V-notch or flying eagle shape on radar. This stems from the fact that the supercell's updraft is very, very intense. Winds cannot go through that supercell updraft. So as flow is diverted around the supercell's main updraft, you get the enhanced V signature. You can also often pick out overshooting tops on infrared satellite imagery, as these very small areas or dots of even further enhanced infrared temperatures within the storm. Overshooting tops signify a very robust thunderstorm and really represent the overall supercell updraft around which that flow diverges, which gives you the enhanced V signature. So infrared satellite can be a great tool to give you a clue as to which storm you maybe want to be targeting when you're out in the field. Now, oftentimes the cloud top temperatures will fluctuate a little bit with time, but oftentimes your more persistent, robust supercells are going to have those really persistent cold cloud tops. And that can tell you if you have a storm, if you have multiple storms in an area, the one with the coldest, the most persistent cold cloud tops can be the one you want to target. In this example, aside from the convective complex in northern Oklahoma and southern Kansas, multiple supercells developed in northwest Texas and moved northeast. Notice how the southern supercell in northwest Texas became more robust with a more persistent overshooting top and more well-defined enhanced V than the northern storms that moved into Oklahoma. This storm actually produced a tornado near the town of Seymour, while the other storms struggled. However, one of the northern storms perked up and eventually produced a robust overshooting top and enhanced V signature, also yielding a tornado west of Oklahoma City. Our final underrated storm chasing tool is differential reflectivity, or ZDR. ZDR is one of our dual polarization radar products that allows us to see the orientation of targets that the radar beam is bouncing off of. Highly positive ZDR values indicate objects that are wider than they are tall, and highly negative ZDR values indicate objects that are taller than they are wide. ZDR values near zero indicate fairly spherical objects. Now, I often see storm chasers using the vertically integrated liquid or VIL product to determine whether a storm has large hail. And this is not an accurate way to accomplish that. While high VIL values can indicate very large hail, it's not always the most accurate because there are a lot of factors that VIL depends on. Storm depth, the characteristics of the actual air mass that the thunderstorm is in, how close to the radar the storm is, etc. Differential reflectivity is a much more effective way to know if a storm has large hail. If a storm has an area of high reflectivity co-located with an area of near zero differential reflectivity, that splotch of gray colors there coincident with the area of high reflectivity, then you can be fairly confident that a storm has large hail in it. So always use differential reflectivity when you're trying to determine whether a storm has large hail or not, as opposed to VIL. So those are my three underrated storm chasing tools and how you should be using them when you're forecasting and when you're out in the field. If you're looking for more information on these tools, check out our Chaser Academy over on stormchasercoaching.com. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.